Hi, my name is Bill Blomquist, and I'd like to welcome you to St. David's online community, On the Road to Pentecost. For the next 6 weeks, we will be looking at sort of a 101 basic course on the Holy Spirit. It will run between now and Pentecost, and so I invite you to follow along either on the website or off of the PDFs that will be posted on the website and contribute on the discussion. The Holy Spirit is elusive in one sense. He's very stealthy because he's hard to pinpoint down. So during our time together, we'll begin to see and learn a little bit more about who he is. And I say he because he is a person. And that's one thing that we'll talk about as well. I like to look at the Holy Spirit in terms of, part of his role is to always give glory to somebody else. You know, so that's why he's so sort of stealthy. In a sense, almost like a satellite dish, for example, outside of our house. We have a satellite dish, but we pay little attention to that satellite dish as it really focuses the reception of the satellite into our living rooms. And, you know, we know that we need the satellite dish, but we would never sort of dissect it. We just know that it's there. The Holy Spirit's like that, too. Just when you think we have him down or we know what he looks like, we find ourselves looking at Jesus Christ, because one of the things that he does best is reveals Jesus Christ. However, we do have scriptural symbols of what the Holy Spirit does, some of his roles, and some of his character. In Scripture, we see the Holy Spirit described as fire in Acts chapter 2, verses 1 and 2, as fire. Many times we have a sense of the peace of God, and I've heard it described that there's a great warmth involved in the power and the presence of the Holy Spirit. Wind is another description in Scripture. And of course, maybe the biggest symbol of all, when John the Baptist was baptizing Jesus, the Spirit of God came down in the form of a dove. You remember that very, very clearly out of John 1:32. But the clouds of God's glory out of Exodus and Numbers and 1 Kings are also descriptive of the presence of the Holy Spirit. And then, of course, he is the indweller of the saints. The Holy Spirit is firstly given to everybody, children, adults, men, women, Greek, Jews, even barbarians, as we come into Christ. He's a gift for all of us. And the second thing I would like to say is that the presence and the power of the Holy Spirit is absolutely essential in the life of a growing Christian. It's not, no thank you, I'd rather not take that, thank you very much. The Spirit has been given to us so that we could carry out the call of God on our lives. The call that he has given each one of us is so great that we can't do it in our own strength. Oh, we might be able to sing a good song or witness a little bit of here and there in our own strength, and for a while it'll float, but for long-term eternal consequence, we cannot do anything outside of the Holy Spirit. We need his power, we need his grace, and we need his presence and his encouragement as we go about doing the things of God. Even the Apostle Paul, I mean, here, the Apostle Paul, very skilled, a very learned man, a man who sat under Gamaliel as a rabbi and really grew up knowing, really grew up having great oratorial skills and debate and so forth. He made it known that he was solely dependent upon the Holy Spirit. In 1 Corinthians, he writes this to the church of Corinth. He says, "When I came to you, brothers, I did not come with eloquence or superior wisdom as I proclaimed to you the testimony of God," which he could have. He was a very smart and charismatic fellow. "But he resolved in his heart to know nothing while I was with you except for Jesus Christ and him crucified." Paul writes in verse 3, "I came to you in weakness and fear and with much trembling. My message and my preaching were not with wise and persuasive words, but with a demonstration of the Spirit's power." So there's a little teaser there. and I hope that that's helpful. And all of this is geared so that when we come in here on Pentecost Sunday, we'll be able to have a pretty good understanding on what to expect and a little bit of a understanding about who He is as we say, "Come, Holy Spirit." I'd like to leave you with a prayer that was written by Christina Rossetti in the early 1800s. She writes this prayer regarding the Holy Ghost. She writes this, "O God, the Holy Ghost, Thou art light unto Thine elect. Evermore enlighten us. Thou who art fire of love, evermore enkindle us. Thou who art Lord and giver of life, evermore live in us. Thou who bestowest sevenfold grace, evermore replenish us. As the wind is Thy symbol, so purify our spirits. As a cloud, so abate our temptations. As dew, so revive our languor. And as fire, so purge out our dross." In Jesus' name, amen.